right in. Guard. Foley. At right guard. James at James and Ryan. Jackson. Signals for a fair catch. James at right end. Tully at left guard. Thank you. 4. Jackson. Pulling. Thank you. Moore and Frank. Lewis. James at right end. Jackson. Flags on the play. Thank you.
Yeah. Good evening and welcome to the WSFA TV Late Show. Tonight, Charles Bronson is hired to do the impossible, to stage a breakout from a high-security prison in Mexico.
Thank you.
15. Alabama.
The MXs would survive the first wave of an attack.
Wallace.
Lurleen was a remarkable, dear, dear lady. And I think she was so natural and so unassuming that everyone could identify with her, relate to her. So, as a first lady, she'd been that way. And she was the sort of lady, I've said, that anyone we know, our wives or our neighbors, anybody could go into the kitchen and have a cup of coffee with and talk about the kids or shopping or whatever. She was just a lovely person. And of course, she was elected as a stand-in. There was no question about it. The Constitution would not allow Wallace to run, George to run again, and he tried to change it, and he was defeated. So he ran her, and of course, she won biggest landslide in Alabama's history, at least in modern times, far bigger vote than George Wallace had ever gotten. Won without a runoff against a very formidable field. But then, of course, she died so tragically, but courageously. Quite a lady. Remarkable lady.
Move on to 1970. You and I have often talked about the Albert Brewer, George Wallace race for governor 1970, and that will go down in history as being one of the toughest campaigns that the state has ever seen.
Without any question, and it's often said that the ugliest kind of fight in the world is a family fight, when members of a family are fighting over an estate, if you please, or a will. This was a family fight. The two had been colleagues. Albert Brewer had gone way out on a limb in 58 and supported George Wallace actively when his neck of the woods was strong for John Patterson. He had paid a price for it. In 62, George handpicked him to be the Speaker of the House. In 66, while there was no team as such, most people, when they voted for Albert Brewer for lieutenant governor, knew they were voting for the man that George Wallace wanted to be lieutenant governor for Lurleen. And then these close ties remained until the first 3 or 4 months of the Brewer administration. Then they began to part ways. And then when George decided to run again, after indicating he would not, feelings were very high. And it was unfortunate. Some things were done on both sides that didn't speak well for the candidates, or at least their campaign workers. It was a very mean campaign.
Brewer actually led in the primary.
Led the first primary, I believe, by about 14,000 votes. And then in the runoff, the Wallace people, and nothing but praise for them. They flat went out and got the votes. It was a textbook effort in the runoff to get people to the polls who were going to vote for George Wallace. All on the up and up, just a beautifully organized campaign. It was a case of the professionals running against the amateurs is what it was. They knew how to do it.
The assassination attempt in May of 72, your recollection of that and where you were and what went through your mind when all of this was going on?
At this point, I was in the magazine business, and I remember it vividly. I was, by coincidence, visiting with a very big Wallace supporter when the call came that Wallace had been shot, and then another call that he was, in fact, dead. And it was these things don't happen. We know about the others, but we didn't know John Kennedy or Bobby Kennedy or Dr. King that well. But George Wallace, it couldn't be. And it was for the first few hours, and there were so many rumors and reports that he could not survive, and then the next one he's dead and all this, but it was a horrible, horrible thing. None of us can imagine the suffering he has gone through. He went through and still does to some degree, but nothing like those first few months. He was at death's door so many times. Just a horrible experience for him.
Is this something from your visiting with him and your knowing him, is this something that he had lived with the thought of having over the years, someone out to get him to the point of trying to kill him?
I think George knew, I know he knew, that because of the controversy that had always surrounded him, that the possibility of this happening was far greater to George Wallace than to most public officials. But let's face it, he aroused the emotions, pro and con. I mean, people will fight for him or they'll fight against him. And I have thought, and at one point some years ago, we even talked to George and I talked about it, the governor and I, that it didn't happen sooner was really somewhat of a surprise, because he was in some, I was with him in some of his speaking engagements when I don't have any doubt if the mob could have gotten to it, they would have killed him. In fact, I think they'd have killed most anybody. They might have killed me, and that's getting, but some of them were quite unruly. Mm-hmm. Unruly is hardly the word. Mm-hmm. But
how do you think that changed the course of national politics to have George Wallace basically removed from the front line of politics?
This will perhaps disturb some of his most dedicated supporters. I don't think Governor Wallace was ever destined to be president or vice president. I never have, even though he was running well in the primaries. I don't think that was likely to have happened. I do think, and he says this, and it gives him comfort, and I think it is said properly, that I think George Wallace had an enormous impact on the direction our country politically, philosophically has gone. There is a remarkable similarity in what Ronald Reagan has said and has sought to do in the last two or three years to what George Wallace was saying back in 68, this nation was going to have to do. We're going to have to slow down on all this spending, and we're going to have to adopt a more conservative posture. And this gives him comfort, he's entitled to it and what he's been through.
Well, let's move briefly through. We had George Wallace elected, reelected in 74, and then in 78... if you want to skip that far away, everybody sat back and said, well, George Wallace is not going to be governor anymore. And lo and behold, a relative unknown from Auburn, Alabama, Auburn, Opelika area, becomes governor. Were you as surprised as mm-hmm. the rest of the state
of
Alabama?
Very much so. Those of us who think we know what's happening in state politics were persuaded that one of the so-called three B's would be the next governor of Alabama. I mean, Brewer had been governor, and Baxley was well known as the attorney general, and Beasley as the lieutenant governor. And what we did not know was that the people were at that point in time were sick and tired of all the politicians, and they wanted a fresh face. And out of nowhere came the football star and the self-made multimillionaire and a good old boy, and what he said, a beautifully orchestrated campaign. I mean, I guess if anybody ever does a piece on the last six or eight governor's races in which television was the most effectively used. It would have to be Faub in 78. It was a beautiful, beautiful job. And credit to the man, Mr. DeLoss Walker, I believe was his name, who masterminded this. But one of the astonishing upsets in my eyes in my lifetime in Alabama politics. But he just won going away. Led the field, and then wasn't any real sweat about the runoff. He was going to beat Mr. Baxter, and I think Mr. Baxter knew it.
How would you assess the James administration from 78 to 82?
I guess I think I've said this in some place, that to me, to have an opportunity and blow it is tough. And I really think overall, Faub, he had such a great opportunity. He was unfettered. Nobody owed him. He didn't owe anybody anything because nobody thought he was going to win. So he just went out on his own.